on this video, we are going to have the definition, examples and few results on characteristic vectors. Definition 6.2.7, characteristic vector. A non-zero vector V in V is called a characteristic vector of T, a linear transmission, belonging to the characteristic root lambda in F if the image of V and T is lambda times V. Here the definition of characteristic vector as well as the criterion for lambda to be a characteristic root, it is the same. Vt equals lambda V, that is the image of V, and T is same as lambda times V. And we must notice that it is a characteristic vector, it is not the characteristic vector, because when we do problems, we will see that corresponding to one lambda, that is characteristic root, we can have number of characteristic vectors. And not only that, it should be a non-zero vector. You cannot have zero to be a characteristic vector. And so these two things are to be noted. It should be a non-zero vector and it is a non-zero vector. So we have an example. We shall consider T from R2 to R2 defined in this way. This is an example what we had already. We talked about characteristic roots, this was the example that we considered. So this is what we have, and phi and minus 1 are characteristic roots of T. Now we try to find characteristic vector belonging to phi and characteristic vectors belonging to minus 1. So in this we use this definition Vt equals lambda V. V any arbitrary vector, so ordered pair xy, and how this one is defined is given here, and that is equal to phi times ordered pair xy. So equating the first component and the second component is what we get, and solving these two we get x equal to y. We can have various values for y, correspondingly we get x. So in general, if you take y to be a non-zero scalar, say k, then we will have ordered pair kk to be characteristic vectors. Other than 0, k can take any value from the field of real numbers. Now if lambda equals minus 1, again we make use of the same definition, and equating the first component and second component, solving these two, we get x is equal to minus 2y. So again, when y takes the value k, your x will take the value minus 2k. So k should not be 0, because 0, 0 is not a characteristic vector. So corresponding to lambda equal to 5, we have characteristic vectors to be ordered by kk, any non-zero scalar. And when lambda equals minus 1, we have ordered by minus 2k, k again as a non-zero scalar. Now we have another example, that is if you consider the vector space of all polynomials of degree less than 3, that means a plus bx plus cx square, where a, b, c are scalars from F. So that collection we are going to have as capital V, that vector space. Now we will define T from V to V in this way. The image of any polynomial f of x under T to be that polynomial plus x plus 1 into the derivative of that. So like this we will have the transformation, and we want to find first characteristic root and then characteristic vector. So we will consider the definition, here we cannot say that this is definition, this is criterion, because we want to determine our lambda. So we will have, this is criterion for lambda to be characteristic root. So f of x, the image of f of x and t is lambda times f of x. So any f of x is quadratic polynomial. So you have a plus bx plus cx square, and here the same. And the way in which it is defined, it is the same polynomial should come here, x plus 1 into the derivative of this. So derivative of this means we have 2cx and b, a becomes 0 on the differentiation. So you have this one is written as such. We shall name this equation as this, the definition of transformation, as star. So by star we have this step, and we will collect the terms containing x square, x and constant term, and here also. So equating the coefficient of like powers, these are the equations that we get. Now we want to determine our characteristic roots. So for which we will have to proceed like this. We multiply equation 2 by lambda minus 3. So this is what we get. And here we have 2 times, I mean, we have lambda minus 3 into c, but that is 0 from 1. So we have lambda minus 3 into lambda minus 2 into b equal to 0. So we cannot have our b to be 0 from here, but all that we will discuss later. So this we shall name as equation 4. Now 3 we have, we will multiply this equation 3 by lambda minus 3 into lambda minus 2. So we have lambda minus 3 into lambda minus 2 into lambda minus 1 into a minus b into lambda minus 3 into lambda minus 2. So but lambda minus 3 into lambda minus 2 b is 0 by 4. So this will not be there and we are left with only this. So we have using 4 we have this one to be the case. And here a here it should be a is non-zero, because if a is 0 say, then automatically b will become 0. If b becomes 0, then automatically from here c will become 0. So it is actually a here, this one, this a should be there. Here a 0 means b will become 0. If b becomes 0, then from 2 c becomes 0. And if c becomes 0, then we will have this a 0, b 0, c 0. So that this will be totally 0, but we want to have f of x to be, if we have this alone, then we will have, see, in case a is non-zero means then also we will get t to be identity transformation, so even that is not allowed. So because that is not the case here, so we don't have it. So in either case we don't have a 0, b 0 and c 0, which means we will have to have lambda minus 3, lambda minus 2, lambda minus 1 to be 0, in turn gives us that lambda equal to 1, 2, 3. Those three values our lambda can take. Now, if we want to find out the characteristic vectors belonging to lambda equal to 1, 2 and 3. So, we shall consider the definition vt is equal to lambda v. Here, v is f of x and lambda is 1. So, this is what we get. This is by the definition of the transformation. So, using star, we have this. And obviously cancelling this f of x, we are left with only f dash of x equal to 0, and integration gives us that f of x equal to a constant, a non-zero constant. And if we have 2 times f of x, that is for lambda equal to 2 we need to find. So we have this is nothing but f of x plus 6 plus 1 into f dash of x, 2 times f of x. And so we will take this to the other side so that we have f of x. So f dashed of x cross multiplying, this is what we get, and integrating we get log f of x equal to logarithm of x plus 1, constant of integration we shall take as log k. Now this in turn gives f of x is equal to kx plus k, where k is non-zero. In the same way for the third one, that is when lambda is 3, this is what we get. And here we have 2 times, because of this, when it goes this side, 2 times we will get cross multiplying. Again the same procedure, and integration gives you this. So when I have 1, k not equal to 0 characteristic vector. When I have 2, I have this. And when I have 3, these are the characteristic vectors. Now we have in theorem 6.2.8 that characteristic vectors are always linearly independent. So that is what is proved in this theorem. If lambda 1, etc., lambda k in F are distinct characteristic roots of T in A of V, and if V1, etc., Vk are characteristic vectors of T belonging to lambda 1, etc., lambda k, then V1, etc., Vk are linearly independent over F. Now, suppose we assume the contrary. Suppose they are linearly dependent over F. Then there exist scalars alpha 1, etc., alpha k not all 0 in F such that the linear combination is 0. So here some of them may be 0, some of them non-zero. So like that, we do not know what are the relation that we can have. So among all such possible relation, there is one with fewest number of non-zero coefficients. So name this statement as statement P. By suitably renumbering the vectors, we can assume that shortest relation to be this. Okay, with beta j, vj and each one non-zero. We shall name that as equation 1. The statement among all such possible relation, there is one with fewest number of non-zero coefficients, that statement is named as statement P, and this is equation 1. Now, since vi's are characteristic vectors belonging to lambda i's, this is what we have. That's by the definition of characteristic vector, name that as equation 2. Now, from 1, as t is well defined, this is what we get. We are applying t on both sides. Now, because t is a homomorphism, in the next step that we are going to have 0 on the right side, and we make use of the second equation to get this step. So this is what we have. We will multiply equation 3 by equation 1 by lambda 1, we get this, and we will have this as such. So 3 minus 4 gives us this, that is these two will get cancelled, giving this. So it's a shorter relation than what we had earlier, and each one, because these are all distinct, each one is a non-zero. So this relation 5 is a relation shorter than 1, and that gives a contradiction to statement B. This is what we had, because that we said that it is the smallest one with, I mean, among all such possible relation, there is only one with fewest number. Now we have got another one. So that is impossible, and the contradiction gives us that V1 its term Vk should be linearly independent. Our assumption is wrong, so we have the theorem. Now we have two corollaries to this theorem. The first one says that if T belongs to A of V and if dimension of V is N, then T can have at most N distinct characteristic roots. Suppose T has M characteristic roots, say. Then by theorem, the previous theorem, they give rise to corresponding set of m linearly independent characteristic vectors. But characteristic vectors are always linearly independent by the previous theorem, and therefore we can have that number of independent vectors to be at the most n. So we should have this m to be less than or equal to n. In other words, T can have at most n distinct characteristic roots. So we have taken T to have m characteristic roots, and that m happens to be less than or equal to n. And so you have this T having at most n distinct characteristic roots. Now corollary 2 says that if T belongs to A of V and if dimension of V is n, and if T has n distinct characteristic roots in F, then there is a basis of V which consists of characteristic vectors of T. We can always find a basis. Okay, so if we have n distinct characteristic roots, then we can always have a basis which are all characteristic vectors. So we shall take lambda 1 etc lambda n in F to be distinct characteristic roots of T, and v1 etc vn to be corresponding characteristic vectors belonging to lambda 1 etc lambda n. Now by theorem 6.2.8, just now we proved that these are linearly independent. We have to have v1 etc vk vn to be linearly independent, and since dimension of v is n and these are linearly independent, they will form a basis of V, and that is by one of the solved problems in section 4.2, linear independence and basis, very first problem. In that we have established that if dimension of V is n and S consists of n number of elements, this is the same. Then for S to be a basis, it is enough I have S to be linearly independent. So here V1 etc Vn are linearly independent, dimension is n, so it will form a basis of V. Now we have few solved problems. The first one is this: if V is finite two-dimensional vector space over the field of real numbers with a basis v1 v2, two-dimensional, so basis consists of only two elements. Now we are asked to find the characteristic roots and corresponding characteristic vectors. What is the T? T is defined in this way. So this problem can be approached by matrices also, that is easier than this, but because matrices comes only in the next section, with the transformation as such we are proceeding to obtain the characteristic roots and characteristic vectors. So let lambda be a characteristic root of T, then there exists a vector V in V such that Vt equals lambda V, that's by the definition. Now V1 V2 is a basis of V, so we have this step. Now we are going to use 2 in 1, so we have this step, and we shall replace our image of V1 under T as given here, and similarly V2T as given here. So this is what we get. We collect the terms containing V1, collect the terms containing V2, and this is the linear combination of V1, V2 equated to 0 element, and V1, V2 being linearly independent, we have to have each scalar to be 0. So we have equation 3 to be this and equation 4 to be this. Right. Now we'll have to solve for lambda. So 3 into 1 plus lambda. We are going to multiply equation 3. This is what we had as equation 3. So multiply this by 1 plus lambda. So we get alpha 1 minus lambda square plus alpha 2 into 1 plus lambda. So that is going to be added with this. So that means the second term will get cancelled. So giving us alpha 1 into 1 minus lambda plus alpha 1. So that means alpha 1 into 2 minus lambda square, because 1 minus lambda, 1 plus lambda. So that gives 1 minus lambda square. And along with this, that gives us 2. Now this implies that lambda square is equal to 2, which means that lambda is plus or minus root 2. Now in this we notice that alpha 1 is not equal to 0. If alpha 1 is 0, then from here alpha 2 will become 0. And so v will become 0, but p should not be 0. It's characteristic vector. So the characteristic roots are plus root 2 and minus root 2. So from 3, from this we can get, from 4 also we can get, we can make use of 2 of these 2. So we have alpha 1 to be alpha 2 into 1 plus lambda. So if alpha lambda equals root 2, then we get v to be alpha 2 into this. This where from we get this, equation 2 is this. So in that we are just substituting, alpha 1 is replaced by this, so we get this. Now this alpha 2 is what? It is any non-zero scalar. Any non-zero scalar, so we shall take it as say some k. So my vector v will be like this, corresponding to lambda equal to minus root 2. Another vector we will have, we shall name that non-zero scalar here in this case to be say some r, just to differentiate and tell. Otherwise the same k can also be used and we have this. So these are the characteristic roots and these are characteristic vectors. Now in this problem, V is again two-dimensional over the field of real numbers and with basis V1, V2, and let T be mapping defined, that is linear transformation defined in this way, where alpha, beta, gamma, delta are in F. Then we are asked to find the necessary and sufficient conditions for 0 to be characteristic root of T in terms of alpha, beta, gamma, delta. So again, the same problem can be dealt with matrices easily, and because it is given in this section, we proceed in this way. And in the second subdivision, we are asked to show that in terms of alpha, beta, gamma, delta, the necessary and sufficient condition for T to have distinct characteristic roots in F. So first subdivision, before we proceed with this, certain concepts are common to both the subdivisions, so that we will see first. Let T be defined in this way. What is given, we have written, name them as 1 and 2. And V1, V2 being a basis of V, small v can be written as A some scalar times V1 plus B V2. So this is equation 3. Now Vt is equal to lambda V we can have, but before to that Vt, which is we have V, you are applying T. So you have A, V1T, T is a homomorphism, so we have this step. And V1T is defined this way, that's from here, the definition of T. So we have this, then collect the terms containing V1 and V2. So if 0 is a characteristic root of T, then Vt should be 0. We are assuming that 0 is a characteristic root and we are obtaining the condition. So we have Vt is equal to lambda V, means that lambda becomes 0. So we have this. This Vt we have already calculated. Just now we calculated, this is what we had. So this is what we have. Now because V1 and V2 are linearly independent, this scalar should be 0 and this scalar should be 0. So from these two together, we arrive at the condition that beta gamma should be equal to alpha delta. So this is the condition for 0 to be a characteristic root of the given transformation. Not in general, but in this case, when it is defined in this way, then this is what we get. So if we want to have 0 to be a characteristic root, then this is what the condition is. Now, if lambda is a characteristic root of T, for the second one, two distinct roots. So for which, again, the procedure is the same. There lambda was 0 and here we have lambda V. Now this Vt already calculated, so that is what is written here. And lambda into V is this one, AV1 plus BV2, and that was equation 3. And we have alpha A plus beta gamma equal to lambda A, because V1, V2 are linearly independent, taking collecting the terms containing V1, collecting the terms containing V2, and because V1, V2 are linearly independent, the scalars should be 0, that is the coefficients. So we have to have the scalars to be 0, so we have from that these two equations. And so this is rewritten in this way. And we make use of this and this. So this is what we arrive at, and this will be quadratic in lambda. So that is simplified in this way. Capital A stands for minus of alpha plus delta, and capital B stands for alpha delta minus beta gamma. This is after simplification. One step is missing in between. So this, when you simplify, finally you arrive at this. Capital A stands for this, capital B stands for this. Now, any quadratic will have unequal roots, that is distinct roots, provided the discriminant is 0. So here the discriminant is a square minus 4b, and that should not be 0. So discriminant should not be 0 for unequal roots. But a stands for this, b stands for this, so we have the condition. So the second one, the condition for T to have distinct characteristic roots, we have distinct characteristic roots we have obtained. And then third one and the last in this solved problems, if we use two dimensional the field A, prove that every element in A of E satisfies a polynomial of degree 2. Now if lambda is a characteristic root of T, then Vt equals lambda V, that's the definition. And Vt we have alpha v1 t plus b v2 alpha, this is a v1 t, this is from the previous problem, continuation of the previous one, because general case only we are discussing. Even there we had the general discussion only, so we make use of that. Okay, so this is what we have. And again lambda square, we simplified all that, plus a lambda plus b, where a stands for this, b stands for this. Now we shall take Q of x to be say x square plus ax plus b. Then Q of V Q of T will be V Q of lambda. This is already established. So V Q of lambda means here we have Q of lambda to be 0, because it's two dimensional over the field. Prove that every element in A of E satisfies a polynomial of degree 2. So we have our Q of lambda. This is characteristic root. When we assume that, then we have this to be 0. So Q of lambda is this, that is 0 already. So B 0 is this is scalar 0, this is scalar 0. So we have V scalar 0 to be vector 0, and this vector 0 is rewritten as the image of V under 0 transformation. So as the images are equal, the mappings must be equal, so Q of T should be the zero transformation, or in other words, T satisfies a polynomial of degree 2, because Q of x is of degree 2, we have this.